Hello and welcome back to Let's Play Adam RPG with me, Brankaton. So I remembered why you don't want to attack the caravans and the random encounters out in the wastes. When you do, the merchants will hire a group of mercenaries to come and hunt you down and ambush you. And it's an extremely difficult fight. They're extremely well equipped, there's a lot of them, and the only way out of that fight without fighting is to bribe them. But it's an absurd amount of rubles. I want to say it's like 10,000. It might be 16,000. But if you can win that fight, you do get a lot of really good equipment and can make a lot of money off of it. But it's not something you want to do in the early game. All right, so a tall, strong man in his 40s. He's armed and dressed like many of his comrades in the bandit camp. But one little detail sticks out. On the sleeve of his thick jacket is a sunburnt tag with blood type. It obviously came from some sort of a uniform. Seeing your approach, the man glances at you as if evaluating your worth. If you have some business, you better speak to my boss. Nah, I just wanted to chit-chat a bit. I'm listening. Talk. What's your name? How are you doing? My name is Taras Gendarenko, but if you want to act a part, call me Sergeant. It was my rank back in the army, and now it's my nickname. As for life, well, it's hard for anyone these days. A soldier, eh? I can respect that. Can you answer some more of my questions? The man looks around and nods. What can you tell me about this place? Ah, rookies. Look around. This is a great place. Well fortified, that's one. Stands in a strategically advantageous place, that's two. We cover most of the ground from here, that's three. And the rest, I don't know. I guess it was some factory before the war. Probably made some bricks here, or teapots. That sounds so sarcastic. Wow, now that's some knowledge. You're a real master strategist, a god of war. Can you grace me with some more answers? Wait a second, are you mocking me? Is that supposed to be some sort of sly British humor? Because if that's the case, I am not getting it. Nah, chill man. I just use some flowery terms. No offense. The man gives you a suspicious eye, scratches his stubbled cheek, and finally relaxes. Now that we passed this awkward situation, can I ask you some more questions? What you doing? My main assignment is to guard our boss, Danon. It's because of him that I'm stuck in this den of thieves. Believe me or not, this man is a natural-born leader. I'm pretty sure that banditry is just a passing phase for him. But the real goal is to bring back law and order, even if just in a couple of the local villages. And for that, I'm ready to lose my good name and even life. You are loyal. I appreciate that in people. I have some other questions. Is there any good information floating around? Back in the day, I served not far away from Molotogorsk City. In the middle of nowhere. Seriously, nothing around but steps. Not even a lousy yurt. I guess that's why this place was selected for testing a new weaponry, the so-called experimental Vitinsky rifle. The rifle was a real beast, light as a feather and compact. And how precise it was. Dragunov is good, but this baby easily eats him in every test run. A Soviet technological marvel, if you ask me. It's made by the same Yaroslavl, a research institute that worked on the Kriaz system before the war. Why even bother? You probably never heard about it anyway. But if in your travels you come across EVR, hold on to it. There's no better weapon out there, of that I'm sure. Fascinating. I hope the super weapon survived the test in upcoming war. I can ask you something else. Alright, that's it. So you can actually find that rifle later on, and it is very good. Hello, Dan. Before you stands a tall man in a dusty suit, with a leather holster on his hip. He looks nothing like the rest of the men around the abandoned factory. He stands straight, his hair is combed, his eyes radiate intelligence. Seeing you, the man straightens his tie and says in a calm, measured tone, I'm listening. Dan, I presume? The same. And who are you? Your real name, please. Dan strokes his large mustache and looks you straight in the eye. Right away, you start to feel uncomfortable. His cold gaze seems to peer straight into your soul. Donnie. The boss writes your name in a small notebook, then looks up again, waiting for you to continue. I was sent here by Kosoi. It's about a job. I see. Why did Kosoi think you'd make a good candidate? We're looking for a very specific type of person. I have a thief's passport. Tch, you one of those types? Alright. Not gonna look a gift horse in the mouth. So you looking for a job? I can ask you some questions. I can see you're quite the jokester, or just plain stupid. I'll answer your questions after you do the deed. Hmm. Can we talk about the job, then? Job. A job. Hmm. The boss clicks his tongue. I do have a job for you, or let's call it a test. Go to the main facility, which we're using as a barracks. Look for the locked door with two guards, and talk to the one named Shishak. They'll give you the rest of your instructions. Nod silently. You made a few words. That's good. Return when you're done and we'll discuss your future. Nod and leave. Alright. Let's go talk to this shirtless man. Ooh, he has a bunch of medicine. Okay, there's a couple of things I want to do real fast. I'm not going to talk to him yet. Let's equip this. The pry bar is really useful. It gives you +10 to lockpicking. It's actually a really good melee weapon as well, but it does have a high AP cost. It does 4 to 22, where this one does 5 to 19, so it has a 3 higher damage. 3 higher max damage, there we go. That's what I'm trying to say. But it does cost a minimum of 4 AP to swing, where this is a minimum of 3. So I get 3 attacks off here, 2 attacks off with this. And then also got this for Fidel. Then I wanted to read this. The Army Magazine, 7/12/1984. Topic: the Patriotic Shooting Gallery of Captain Zeminski. That's not that much. In our day and age, peace amongst men is something that every Soviet citizen dreams of. Who would not want to live under the new age, when capitalism stops struggling and accepts the superior ideology of Marxism-Leninism? This could be a glorious age indeed. An age when our Soviet nation, which already holds out a hand for peace, will stop being spat on by the evil forces of the world that seek to provoke us for open conflict. An age when we could all cite the great Leninist writer and martyr Hemingway by proclaiming a farewell to arms. An age when shooting becomes a simple sport for all ages, instead of a means to kill fellow human beings. Every Soviet citizen wants just that, because we already live in a peace-loving, pacifist country. But the Western aggression makes us forget this dream, at least for the time being. The sad truth is also known to the head of the 18,903rd Shooting Gallery of Ust-Katharinsk, World War II veteran Sevalod Borisovich Zeminski, who turned his workplace into a real boot camp for young fighters. Here he teaches the ABCs of guerrilla warfare to kids that are still too young for true combat training. For the sake of this article, we have visited one of his lessons with 3 young pupils, the 8-year-old Zina, the 9-year-old Kostya, and the 10-year-old Vadim. What do we have here? Oh, Zina, you call that killing a man? Asked the strict teacher while looking at a paper cutout of an American soldier that the little girl used for target practice. Yes, you shot him in the side of the throat. Yes, you made some holes in his belly. So what? You know how much time a man can stay alive with such injuries? Enough to make mincemeat out of you. Haven't I told you how quick their M16 rifles are? Yes, they jam a lot and are utterly unreliable. They put a whole magazine into you in just a few seconds. I saw plenty of that in Vietnam. I'd see plenty of that if I was secretly fighting in Vietnam by government orders, which I was not. Now, if you're shooting his throat, try to hit the middle, so cripple his backbone. But I'd rather you aim between the eyes or at the kneecaps. You know how much it hurts when they get you in the knees? The guy would collapse instantly and scream his lungs out, as you finish him with the bayonet. The girl quietly nods. She looks rather sad because of her mistakes, but that frown quickly turns into a smile, as she promises she will never let her mentor down again. The piercing sound of the whistle signals for little Vadik to start shooting. I think it's supposed to be Vadim. That was the other boy's name. The boy sticks his tongue out and begins methodically shooting a pig carcass that was gifted to the shooting gallery by the 7th Ust-Katharinsk slaughterhouse. Despite the boy shooting from the hip, each bullet hits its mark, making the carcass shake as if alive. But alas, last shot isn't a bang, but only a sad little click. The TT gets jammed. You're pretty good, says Comrade Zeminski, with a smile, while taking the pistol from the boy and ejecting the jammed bullet by hand. But where'd you pick up that technique? Did you see it in some action movie? Never try out a technique you're not properly acquainted with, and don't bend your elbow like that after each shot to dampen the recoil. That's more of a revolver technique. I don't think I've read this last time I played through. That is a Metal Gear Solid reference, Metal Gear Solid 3 specifically. That's hilarious. I mean, this whole book is hilarious, but anyway. I'm not training for future sports stars or trick shooters. I'm making them into warriors that will get up from their school desks and fight to the death if need be, states Comrade Zeminski. Don't forget everything the movie's like. They'll forget everything the movie's like, the white side of the desert, or spaghetti westerns taught them. I'll teach them to fight like real child soldier, like a real child soldier fights. After such an impressive speech, the only thing we could do was congratulate Comrade Zeminsky on his methods, and wish great luck to his patriotic project. That gave us 14 points into pistols and SMGs, which we would not be using. I wonder if I could have had Fidel use that. We can make a few bucks. Sure. And before you stands a muscular man with a buzz cut, wearing a dusty t-shirt. On his wide naked shoulder there's a simple yet expressive tattoo, the word Mama encircled by a bleeding, arrow-pierced heart. His pouty face doesn't show any interest towards you. His meaty eyebrows almost connect when he deducts you're about to speak with him. Hey there, can I ask you some more questions? What, are you going to interview me about my criminal record? Yep, I was part of such a deal once, back before the war, when I served time in prison. One day they sent over some students who were learning the profession of prison guards. So they interviewed us on random stuff, gawked at us too. I felt like I was a rock star, or an animal at the zoo. Anyway, what did you want from me again? How's life? I'd say I'm living like a hungry lost dog, but I don't want to compare myself with some mutt. Man's best friend. Yeah, right. More like the best friend of any stranger that would feed it. Nah. I don't want no comparison with those filthy things. So I'll say I'm living like a wolf. Yeah, that's about right. Sure. Tell me about this place. On cold nights it seems like even feral animals have better layers. But all in all, it's an okay place. There's a factory here once, as you can see, but the guys fortified it and made it livable. Also, it's great for surveillance. We can see all the surrounding lands from here. Yeah, I got your point. And what are you busy with? What else can an honest man do in the den of thieves? I guard, I patrol. If someone finds a good place to loot, I take part in the expedition. When it's time to get the taxes from a nearby village, I do that too. They're lazy people when it comes to paying taxes. Good thing my fists quicken their pace, one broken nose at a time. The man cracks his knuckles in a demonstration of sorts. Isn't that something? Tell me some rumors. I was quite the rumor monger some time ago, 10 years ago to be precise. I was literally obsessing over hearsay on a particular topic I asked everyone about. But nobody could tell me any rumors about it, because it concerned a place that was considered far away even before the war, and is now considered unreachable. But one day, me and the boys, we got ourselves a merchant from distant lands. He had a portable safe traveling with him, and didn't want to open it. So the boys sent me to help him remember the combination. But when I got to him, I started asking him about my thing instead. Tell me, I said, is there a city called Trudozadosk near Khabarovsk? Did it survive the war? Is it safe? The merchant said nothing at first. I asked him again, like I did to thousands of others, but he wasn't like them, because he finally gave me an answer after whimpering and crying for a bit. And what did he say? There is no more Trudozadosk. Trudozavodsk, he said. The city only lives in local legends. I traveled near the place it once occupied with the Guangzhou caravan, and didn't even see a single building left. It's a barren plain now, a place of ashes and sun-bleached rocks. And that's how he answered. You know, I should have felt happy about it. Finally, my rumor hunt was over. But instead of getting all sentimental, I strangled him and sank his freaking luck box in a ditch. Because Trudozavodsk was my city of birth. Yep, left my mama there. Left without saying goodbye. Deep in my heart, I always knew the city was probably destroyed in the war. I felt that mom never survived. How could she? Yeah, I guess I always knew that I'd never see her again. But I had doubts, and doubts gave me hope. And when that freaking merch told me his words, he severed this hope from my soul. I still see the ashes and sun-bleached rocks he told me about, you know. These ashes are what's left for my home. My mama, and Yura, my older brother. This is why I'll tell you the following. Don't ask around about rumors. Sometimes it's better not to know. What a story. Alright. Thought I saw the shirtless guy walk by. Maybe I was mistaken. I'll do it once around back here. I don't think there's anything to find back here. Well, there's a shirtless guy. He's one that had all the medicine on him. And I can sell this. This will come in handy down the road, and we can grab one of those. Well, it's not too expensive. Let's see. I am 6 rubles short. I'll just pay for those. No, I won't. Have that mushroom instead. I see a half-naked thin man with an empty stare. He looks at you without blinking. His body is covered with different intricate tattoos, probably of prison origin. Hey, can I ask some questions? Instead of a reply, the man first loudly sniffs and spits to the side. He nods only after that. How's life, pal? The man sniffs again without saying anything. You lose all hope of getting a reply before he finally starts talking. His voice sounds like it's coming from far away. I'm like I'm in a dream, man. After they knifed me, I decided to treat myself to some tranquilizers, but yeah. What were you asking me? Doesn't really matter, my man. The man spits on the ground and quietly eyes you with his empty stare. Tell me about this place. The man looks around and blinks, then turns to you and says, What? What do you want from me? Quit messing with me, man. I'm guarding the base, you know? The base which is in the old factory. Wow, what a scene. What are you busy with? The man touches his face. Seems like he forgot his body shape, since he looks surprised afterwards. You think I'm some junkie? I'm guarding the factory. I've got duties, you freak. I have a duty to walk around, you know. And wait, what am I even doing? Oh right, guarding the base. Can't you see? Oh, tell me some rumors. The man livens up slightly and gives you a semblance of a smile. You notice his teeth are rotten. Most are blackened. Some are gone completely. Ha ha ha. Ever heard of the hypnotic toad? I was watching it on the TV, you know the channel Krasno uses to brainwash the local idiots? Heh, they lied about everything. Fake news, I tells ya. Old media can't give us anything new, dude. Long live the thieves. But what? Sorry. Yeah, I got your point. We're not gonna get a lot out of that guy. He's a little toasted. Empty bottle. At the very least, we can sell it for a ruble. Tires can be used to be made into tire armor if I had the crafting for it. It's a pretty good early game armor. Also, there's a merchant that shows up here. He sells, at least last time he sold, some pretty good stuff. The last playthrough he sold. Rolls around in bed. Okay. Spiked club, which is one of the higher end weapons that I remember. I doesn't have rubles, so it's probably not worth trying to trade with him. Well, maybe. Let's see, what can I do here? If I can get one of these out of him, that'd be worthwhile. Oh wait, yeah, it's already more than I need. Yeah, go ahead and do that. Before you stands a slim, busy looking man. He watches you silently. Apparently he doesn't want to start the conversation. Hey there, can I ask you some more questions? Hey, well go ahead and ask. We'll see if I want to answer or not. Now, how's life? It's okay. Lost a buddy some time ago. He went into Krasno, you know, to score some babies. Said he'll spend the night at some old hag's gas station on the way to the city. Nobody's seen him since. Maybe I should go look for him. Nah, it's his fault for taking such a crooked route to the city. If he's indeed lost, so be it. Also, I owed him some money, so don't bother. Like I always said, nothing's more important than good friends. Tell me about this place. Oh, sorry, the man shrugs. He obviously doesn't care much. Tell me about this place. It's our base. We're holed up for good, just like in some fancy castle. Nobody can jump us by surprise. Not from any side. Alright, I got your point. And what are you busy with? Business as usual. I go to meetings with other groups. I rob the merchants. I loot abandoned homes. That's not all of it. Jobs just keep on coming. Quite the set of activities. Now tell me some rumors. Now, nothing to tell. I'm not one to trust rumors. Alright, I get that. Not the most exciting conversationalist. What do you got, buddy? Nothing good, okay. You see an energetic man, He looks around 25. He's wearing a simple jacket. He smiles at you when you move in closer. Hey, can I ask you some questions? Hey there, Wanderer. Ask all you like. I have nothing to do apart from chatting. The day is too calm for anything else. Now, how's life? It's okay. I left the guys I was hanging out with before, and thank God for that. With my new crew, I don't feel like the scum of the earth anymore. Here in the factory, we're all men of higher purpose. Yep, that we are. And that's just great. Tell me about this place. Look around. Quite the place, right? Well, all of this is ours, you know. Me and the boys, we own it. Not bad, huh? It'll last a lifetime. Some guys are resting, some are on patrol duty. That's what I call living. I see. What are you doing? What do you think I'm doing? I'm just chilling, thinking about stuff. All that while watching the perimeter so that nobody gets in without an invitation or a bullet hole in the face. It's my day off, but still, I stay vigilant. Yep. Why did you get a day off? All of my days are days off. Students live life between exams. We live life between raids. Every day is a holiday when you don't have to mess anyone up. Haha. I see. Tell me some rumors. Ha, a fellow connoisseur of gossip. Respect, my man. Ever heard of the Shaking Forest? It's a place in the wastes. Never been there myself, but people say it looks like an ordinary little grove. Nothing special about it. But some days, trees that grow there start shaking without any wind. Don't you dare laugh. It's completely serious. I once told this story to a scientist. He laughed too. He said it can't be true, because earthquakes only happen where the tectonic plates collide or something like that. Maybe you want to give me that same reason, huh? Well, don't. As a guy who grew up in a home located near the railroad tracks, I can honestly say that you don't need no tectonic plates to make the ground shake. All you need is a heavy train to pass nearby. Before the war, we had heavy-duty trains pass near our house. Each time that happened, the windows shook inside our flats, and even the doors creaked and opened on their own sometimes. There must be an underground train system under that little grove. Trains, made for the surviving members of the Politburo or something even scarier. Yep. You feel like your company loosened the man's tongue a little bit. He has something more to tell you. What a story. Anything else you can tell me that is good? That is that good? There we go. Well, you seem like an okay guy. Okay, I'll tell you my origin story. Nowadays they call me Stas. When I ran with another crew, I was called Stas the Knifer, a desperate son of a gun. You know why I stopped being this guy and came to live here? Once, after getting a butt cheek full of lead, I was sealed up in an abandoned building while the other boys of my former gang were investigating that same grove I told you about. None came back. I waited for a week. Not a single one returned from the Shaking Forest. Yep. Okay, because there's some notes and stuff you can find in that location. And I think they belong to his previous crew then. Before you stands an old man with a scruffy beard. He's gazing unhappily down at the wounded man lying in bed. The old man sighs from time to time as he looks over the yellowing bandages on his friend's chest and stomach. Hey, why so sad, Chad? He looks at you with disgust. What, are you blind or something? Can you see this wounded man lying here? The Palnyanka got knifed by those bastards who came from the woods to attack the village. Who are you anyway? What do you want? If it's not important, you better go. I'm doing a crappy job healing my pal as it is. Somebody knife your pal over there? Yep. Freaks is all they were. Sickos wandering the countryside, fighting us at every turn. One good thing is we killed them all in that last fight, but not before they cut up my buddy here. You seem like a straightforward kind of fella. You can ask him for the details yourself if you wanna. I see. Care to ask him, care to answer more questions? Fine. Maybe I'll tell you something interesting. How's life? We already talked about life, I think. Alright, right. Tell me... The man crosses his arms and looks at you quietly. Tell me about this place. The factory. Probably not the greatest place to rebuild civilization, but it suits our needs just fine. We cope. Still beats living in the wild, I guess. And what are you busy with? In my old age, field work is not that easy. I mostly help out with advice, but once in a while I do something more action-oriented. Yep. Tell me some rumors. I've seen many ruffians in my time. I haven't acted like one many years ago. Lots of folks met their maker because of me. but those three brothers that wanted to join us a few months ago, dang. They were complete savages, worse than any bandit I ever met. Even the youngest was a total nut job. Dan sent them on a simple mission to test them, and they never returned. So maybe we won't have people like that joining our ranks after all. Let's hope not. Alright, cool. A man shivers slightly on a dirty bed. He looks up at the ceiling with unblinking eyes, breathing heavily. His broad chest has been sloppily bandaged with yellowing rags. Quit your staring. I have plenty of holes in me already without your eyes drilling more. I just wanted to talk. The wooden bandit lifts himself up on one elbow, barely, and looks you over. Well, what do you want to talk about? Who are you? Those who have reason to fear me call me Leonid Petrovich. To my pals, I'm just Lyonka. Lyonka the Hitchhiker. Nice to meet you, Leonid Petrovich. My name is... The bandit waits expectantly. Donnie, Kogan the Barbarian. A name like any other. I've heard worse. I can ask another question, then. The man replies with a hacking cough. Tell me about this place. Nice place, right? We settled here a few years ago. We were worried at first, because it seemed too large to defend against other gangs, but then we fortified it. Some gangs live in old barns, some settle in tents. We've got a freaking factory. Now that's a base to die for. Have you ever thought about resuming production? You're crazy, man. How do you resume something which stopped way back before the war? Although maybe someone smarter than me would see things differently. I got your point. What's wrong with you? The bandit laughs out loud. What are you, blind? I got knifed, you idiot. Knifed by a freaking kid. Ha. It happened a month ago when we heard some rumors about a gang of crazies heading for Ultranoye. These guys were scavengers, animals. People like them burned villages on a whim. We didn't want that fate for Ultranoye. We survived by taking protection money from that village, so we fight for them when they're threatened. We decided to ambush those freaks on the road, hid ourselves in the woods and waited for them to pass. It worked. Right away we put down half of them in a storm of bullets. The other half though, gosh darn, they were really crazy. None of them panicked, nobody ran. Instead they literally ran towards our guns, wielding knives and clubs. A couple had nothing better than pointed sticks. We got them all in the end, but not before one stuck a shiv in my stomach. Took me by surprise, the dirty freak. I was reloading when he came at me. A crazed kid, nothing else. I messed him up real good, not gonna lie. Hit him so hard his skull shattered. But like I said, he managed to stick me like a pig first. Now I'm half dead. Anyway, you can see the guys didn't want to leave me there to die. They washed the wound and bandaged me as best they could. But that's not enough, you know? Unless a real doctor, a proper pre-war doctor, does something about this wound, I'm already dead. Like that one in the village not far from here, Mikoyan, I think his name was. What are the odds of him coming all this way for a house call? And if we force him, he'll just kill me and say there was nothing he could do. He's a man of principles. He hates our kind. I can speak with Dr. Mikoyan for you. The man obviously doesn't trust you. Are you serious, pal? Because there's no reason to con a dead man. But if you are for real, heh, I'd pay you well. All the money and ammo I've got will be yours. Darn it, I'll give you my last pair of pants if you pull this off. Yeah, I promise. We'll have you walking again in no time. The wounded man lifts himself up with much effort. You'd save my life, and I would owe you for the rest of my days. Uh-huh, but first let me ask you some questions. How are things, man? You still alive back there? Haha, funny. I'm struggling, but I'm not ready to bite the dust. Yet. You better hurry, though, or I'm a goner. So I keep mentioning time-sensitive quests. This is one of them. At the start of the game, you have one in-game month to resolve this quest before he dies. So, we still have plenty of time. What rumors have you heard lately? The bandit is disgusted with you. Ever heard of the crap they talk about us in Ultranoye? Frick my life. They call us bandits. Animals. They only knew what kind of crap we see every day in the wastes. They only knew the horrors we've stopped just beyond the borders of their freaking village. They pay us well then. Oh yeah. They're just too stubborn to believe we're protecting them. I doubt they ever will. They think if a man at one point in his life is forced to steal, he can never be trusted. He can never have honor. Yeah, right. So we treat them exactly as they expect we will, and we take their money without telling why we do it. Did you try to tell them that? Maybe then an amazing friendship would blossom between you guys and the village. The man thinks any words over with a smile. Huh, that would have been great. But I'm not much of a diplomat, to be honest. Hurts to speak at all in my condition. Yeah, that's too bad. Alright. So we finally got that quest. Can I take out of this, or are they gonna get mad? Nope, they don't care. How about this one? Alright, two more NPCs to talk to. We'll start with this guy. Oh, you see a short, nimble guy who keeps watch in front of some undistinguished door. He quietly talks with his comrade. Upon seeing you, waves his hand in salutation. He looks at you with a crooked smile. Hey there, Chief. Hi, can I ask you some questions? Shoot. How's life around here? The man smirks and winks at you. How's life? It's not that bad. But it could be even better if we would have some fine broads. You know what I'm talking about? He draws two formidable spheres in the air and winks at you again. With a great big rack. Do you want me to show you the size of the butt? Well, my hands are not that long. How original. Keep him coming, Chief. Tell me about this place. Well, you're not blind. Look for yourself. Maybe you want to know something that you can't see. Some secrets. Am I right or am I right? No such luck, Chief. These lips are sealed. Well, stop bullcrapping me, butthole. Or you want to dance on the blacktop? Hey, no smoke, Chief. You wanted to talk. Well, I'm talking to you, ain't I? And what are you busy with? I'm just minding my own business. Looks like he wants to add something, but unsure if he should. Oh, come on. Tell me about it. I know you want to. The man looks at you with unexpected austerity. Heard that one Curious George got jacked up with his shiv for asking too many questions. If you don't want to meet with a terrible fate like that, better stop pushing people for answers that they don't want to give. Okay, I'm not pushing. Have you heard any rumors? You want some rumors, eh? Well, there's talk that our favorite little hamlet, Ultranoye, was visited by some really strange dude recently. He was buff, like some of the boys here in the camp, and he had this weird manner of talking, like he's from the army or something. Not to mention that he used some scientific terms and old stories about Georgia. A real piece of work, I tell you. He's talking about Alexander. He drank half of the vodka in the tavern, even tried putting the moves on the local broad. It goes without saying that he failed miserably, since that gal was colder than the Siberian winter. And good for her. The dude obviously has history behind him. It'd be great to interrogate him. Such cell warriors usually mean bad news. You have a sneaky suspicion that the man in question is your colleague from the Atom, Alexander. You silently swear that this great ability to stay out of the radar. Or swear at his great ability to stay out of the radar. Before you stands a broad-shouldered man with cold, cruel eyes. He's quietly discussing something with his comrade. But as you approach, he looks at you from under dark brows. There's an unpleasant smile pasted on his face, as if he's planning something against you. Hi, can I ask you some questions? Do I have a reason to talk to you? I don't think so. Get out, kid. Look him straight in the eye. Your interlocutor's friend clearly wants to say something. After a glance at him, quickly reconsiders. The man again turns to you and looks you in the eye. He doesn't look away and doesn't even blink. The ominous smirk gradually disintegrates. At last, he interrupts the prolonged silence. What are you staring at? Want to confess your undying love to me? I'll tell you straight. Dudes are not my cup of tea. Continue to stare at him. The man grins and answers you the same. However, the smile gradually slides off his face. He looks back, not from a position of strength, but as if responding to a challenge from you. Turn away. Nice smiling contest we had there. You turn away and clearly feel the man's burning gaze on your back, but he stays silent. At this stage, the incident is exhausted. Okay, are you by any chance Shishak? You again. What is it this time, son? I'm not a champ. I'm looking for a real job. The man spits and fixes you with a cold stare. At last he takes out a bunch of keys and begins to reluctantly sort through them. Who cares? Well, I guess you won the lottery today. I'm Shishak. Now, I need to give you a little test. Wait patiently. Shishak starts whistling to himself. He goes through the keys again from the start, happy to take as much time as he needs, and maybe a little more. We need to unlock this door, son, and as you can see, there's a barrel's worth of keys on this ring. Most of them don't even open anything in the camp. They were just kicking around when I found it. Never got around to sorting out the useful from the useless. Hope you understand. Wait patiently. Shishak yawns and lazily stretches his neck. He then proceeds to search for the right key. He takes his sweet time, periodically grunting out a meaningless observation to the man standing next to him. Which is the correct one? I can't seem to remember. Heck, excuse me, son. This is a bit awkward. Yeah, real awkward. Nod silently. Time passes, or at least you assume it does. It seems as though Shishak's forgotten about the right key, about you, and about everything else in this weary world. He slowly and deliberately runs his finger around the key ring, stretches, and only occasionally raises his eyes to you with a slight grin. Finally, he snaps his finger and removes an unremarkable brass key from the ring. Oh, here it is. Well, you can see how quick I am. No need for nagging, boy. Finally. Before you stand Shishak, a square-built man with cold, cruel eyes. He's looking at a huddled prisoner with a gag in his mouth. The prisoner is squirming in the grimy floor, trying his best not to look at anyone in the room. He's obviously in fear of a beating. Looky here, kid. We keep our guests in this room. He squats in front of the prisoner, who instinctively recoils and shrinks down on himself even further. Shishak then starts clapping his hands near the man's head in a constant rhythm. The prisoner winces with every clap. He was a little tense. His silence made no sense. I saw the little piece of crap and put him in a bloody bag. Ha, our body bag. Why are you so antsy? Stop shivering and look me in the eyes, you stupid freak. Blinking uncontrollably, the prisoner raises his watery eyes to Shishak. The bandit clicks his tongue and clenches his large fist in the prisoner's face. The man flinches back, but Shishak only grins and dusts off his pants. He looks at you and spreads his hands. He's a nervous fellow, and a quiet type. Maybe because of the gag. Ha! Now who is he? Some schmuck from Ultranoye. Talked up a storm about his money, but was it worth it? I don't think so. So now he has free accommodations in our luxury apartments. Believe me, in the beginning I was gentle with him. I just gave him a couple of quick chin checks, that's all. But he kept screaming, something along the lines of, I said some stupid things, I have nothing on me. He's bluffing, I'm telling you. Okay, what do I need to do? Your job is easy peasy. Look here. Shishak reaches into his jacket, pulls out a polished TT gun, and hands it to you, grip first. This is a gun with one bullet, and here's this mutton head. The rest is up to you. You've got a carte blanche. Kill him right away, or extract a little payment first. I don't really care since he only plays one sad tune. I don't have any money, I'm not a millionaire. Only the grave will fix what's wrong with him. That's some vigorous abuse of vital organs. The bound prisoner begins to shudder, and mumbles something into his gag. He looks up at you with a mixture of hope and fear, but leaning more towards fear. Shishak takes a couple of steps back and watches with interest. The second thug joins him. Aim at the prisoner. You aim the gun at the prisoner. The bound man begins to quietly whimper and slowly crawls away from you. His gaze, as full of terror as a wounded deer, is fixed on the muzzle of the gun. Shoot him in the head. You pull the trigger and nothing happens. Instead of a shot, there's only a clicking sound. The magazine is empty. You look at Shishak in astonishment while the captive, still unscathed, quietly sobs on the floor. Shishak throws you a cheerful wink as he takes the gun from your hands. Ha! You really thought it was loaded, son? What a clown. Turns out this lucky bastard has a use after all. I see if like he didn't tell us everything. We also got to see you from an interesting angle. You're actually going to gun him down in cold blood. Yeah, Shinir Kam Zumir? The man gestures his friend over, whispers something in his ear, then slaps him on the back. Shinir runs out of the room. Now go. Let's see what Dan has to say about all of this. Interesting what passes for a test around here. See you. So I knew that I wasn't going to kill him. Oh, that's the mechanic that we're supposed to be rescuing from the, I don't know if I'm going to get in trouble for stealing this stuff. But let's loot this real fast. Then we'll go... We'll talk to Dan in the next episode. I'm not going to do that here. I'm already over time. I just wanted to finish talking to all the NPCs and the factory this episode so we could move on with questing in the next one. Oh man, that's a lot of reading. Ah, my voice started to struggle there towards the end. But alright, in the next episode we'll talk to Dan, turn in that quest, and get his next quest. We'll also try to go back to Ultranoye and see about convincing Dr. McCullion to come here and fix up. Was that the other guy? Hey, talk to this guy. Alright, I've already talked to that guy. Okay. Yeah, we should have talked to all the NPCs here. I think that was everybody. Anyway, gonna call it here. Already said what we're gonna do next time. Thanks for watching. I hope to see you guys in the next one.